your face covering, or D, a Starbucks Mocha Frappuccino Light? The correct answer is C. Face coverings are required in all Hillsborough County public schools. You can wear masks, shields, or gaiters, as long as they don't cause a distraction in class. But you must have it covering your mouth and nose at school when you're not properly distanced.
Question number 3. You're heading to lunch, and you know you have to wash your hands first. You head into the bathroom, and using soap and water, you wash your hands for A. 2 seconds, a quick splash under the water will do. B. 10 seconds, that's to be enough, right? C. A half hour, better safe than sorry. Or D. 20 seconds. The correct answer is D. The CDC recommends washing your hands thoroughly with soap and water for 20 seconds. Make sure to get the tips of your fingers and scrub under those nails.
Question number 4. You cannot wait to talk to your friends about that project your science teacher just assigned. What do? A. Gather in the hallway, huddle close together, and compare notes. B. Meet up in the restroom, remove your face covering, and spend several minutes discussing ideas. C. Wait until after class when you can safely gather outside, socially distanced, and talk about the project. The correct answer is C. There will be signs in hallways asking students and staff to stay to the right and only walk in one direction. Administration will discourage any gathering in the restrooms. It's always safer to wait until you can gather with your friends outside and make sure you're 6 feet apart before socializing.
So, how'd you do on your COVID-19 pop quiz?
Let's review.
If you are not feeling great when you wake up in the morning, stay home. Don't take the chance that you could spread your germs.
Never leave home without your face covering. They are required at Hillsborough County Public Schools.
Always wash your hands thoroughly with soap and water for at least 20 seconds.
If you have to cough or sneeze, do it in your elbow or a tissue. But be sure to throw the tissue away and wash your hands.
And do not gather in hallways or the restrooms. Outside, socially distanced, is the safest way to talk with your friends.
Great job! You get an A+ when it comes to preventing COVID-19 in school.
You know, today's another step that shows that Hillsborough County Public Schools has taken, the right steps in order to further protect our students and our employees when we return to school. And, we're going to put MERV 13 air filters in every one of our classrooms and every one of our common areas and every one of our district offices in order to have a better filtration system. As you know, CDC guideline and ESHRA, they continue to talk about MERV 13s and how they are another proactive solution to be able to capture particles within the air and also be able to bring outside air within closed confined areas with our classrooms. So this is another step. We know that MERV 13s, they capture 90% of the particles that are with microns between 1 and 3, and also 50% of the particles that have microns between 0.3 and also with 1. So this is just another step to show that we have a system of care for every one of our stakeholders.
Okay, so these are the two filters. This is the existing filters that are in the district currently in the HVAC systems. This is the proposed filter. And the first thing you would notice is that at first glance, it doesn't look to be a lot different. The primary difference is the media that is in the filter right here. So it's a little bit thicker. It's got a different material that's designed to filter out different size particles. So as you go up in MERV rating, MERV rating, you filter out more particles. So MERV 13 is very near the top end. As you put these in, you're filtering out much more of the particles in the air.
Ever since the CDC came out and they said that MERV 13 is the way to go, whether it's in your home, whether it's in buildings, whether it's in the educational system and schools, they've been significantly hard to get, no different than PPE. So, we were able to connect with a vendor in order to get them and receive them within our school district. And we know that it's a national shortage. So we will have the first wave completed starting on August 24th. And then we will continue to be able to have full completion by October 1st within every one of our classrooms that have an air filter in every one of our facilities.
So what we're doing is, as we receive signage and things like that, we're going ahead and we're looking at the controlled movements that we're doing. We're actually even doing some role plays with just the faculty and staff so that we can leave room for error so that we can figure out anything that could possibly go wrong and we address it. We did address with our faculty a very extensive list for both faculty and students. And what we did was we mapped out the day for all students and all faculty, and we thought of safety parameters at all times. So as we establish signage, that's just being aligned with our protocols and our structures. We got a large stack of directional signs, safety first. We made some signs for our bathrooms too, just reminding students of safety protocols, because sometimes it's just not, you know, it's not the first thing we think of, but we need it to be the first thing. So we got a large stack, and now we're going to go throughout our building and place them anywhere we have students and teachers present. I do imagine, to be honest, that it's going to feel different for kids, right? And so what's really important to us is that they know our heart under our mask. And so our teachers have filmed themselves to place on their Canvas page so that kids can meet them without the mask, right? Because we know that that relationship piece is still super important. And I imagine it's a little scary for kids, but I hope that we're gonna stress to them that if we all abide by the structures, then our safety will be met, our safety needs will be met, so that we can then move to relationship builders, team builders, educational learning, right? All of those big pieces, but we know that we have to put safety first.
I'm Lynn Gray, school board member for District 7, countywide, and you're watching Hillsboro Schools TV.
This time of year, there's a good chance someone you know or you will get sick from the flu. And there's another illness called coronavirus, which is making people sick. When it comes to any illness like these, you should not be scared, but you should be smart about staying healthy. Here's what to do. Wash your hands with soap and water for at least 20 seconds. That's as long as it takes to sing the happy birthday song two times. Do that a lot, especially every time you eat and after you go to the bathroom. If you can't wash your hands, use hand sanitizer. Don't touch your eyes, nose, or mouth unless you wash your hands first. If you cough or sneeze, do it into your elbow or your sleeve, not in your hand. You can also cover your cough or sneeze completely with a tissue. Then throw the tissue away and wash your hands. If someone is feeling sick, don't get too close to them. No hugs, no high fives. And if you are sick, stay home. That'll keep other people healthy and help you to rest and get better faster. Also, if there are places that a lot of people touch, clean and disinfect them often. If you feel sick, especially if you think you have the flu, call your doctor. And remember, don't be scared. Be smart about staying healthy.
The School District of Hillsborough County has developed Fortify FL, a new app that lets you call 911 or contact the authorities about suspicious activity or an emergency safe, easily, and anonymously. If you see an emergency, all you need to do is open the app, press call 911 or send tip, and fill out the tip report. This app is available from the Google Play Store and the Apple App Store. Type Fortify FL, install the app, open the app and allow notifications. No sign up or account needed. And remember, if you see something, say something.
All schools in Hillsborough County can start a walking school bus program to build community, enhance student health, and promote safety. So how do you get started? Here are five simple ways to start a walking school bus program at your school. First of all, let me define what is a walking school bus program. In the simplest terms, it's a group of children walking to school with one or more adults. It can be as informal as two families taking turns walking their children to school, or something much more structured, with designated meeting points, a timetable, and train volunteers. The first step is to develop a strong volunteer base of PTA members, parents, and community members. This is so important to ensure that there is an appropriate number of adults to supervise the number of children who are walking. The second step is for the adult volunteers to pick a route and take a test walk. It's important that the adult volunteers identify a safe walking, biking route to school. Find a route that includes crosswalks, sidewalks, and crossing lights to ensure safety. The third step is to decide how often the group will walk together and share this schedule with the community. The fourth step is to develop community support so that you'll have prizes and giveaways to make walking as a group a fun activity. The last step is to invite families who live nearby to walk. Join the movement and start a walking school bus program for health, community building, and safety.
Hi, I'm Lynn Gray, school board member for District 7, countywide, and you're watching Hillsborough Schools TV.
The students from the modeling and simulation class and the APCSP class are designing and putting together the ornaments that we're going to be delivering to Sullivan Elementary. We just felt that we wanted to do something, you know, for the community in the spirit of the holidays. The prototype, right, or the original needs to be designed, and we use a program called Blender to do a lot of our work in here. And then once the prototype is made, we take it to the 3D printer. Then we'll mix epoxy together, pour it in the mold, and let it set for about 20 minutes. From that point on, we'll paint and drill a hole in it and put some ribbon around it and make it look like an ornament. I still think hands-on is one of the best ways to learn, you know, and when you're, the great thing about the 3D printer and using these programs is when you create something and you're able to interact with it, right? I think that stays with you forever.
Happy holidays!
It's for tonight. This is my stuff for tonight. Mm-hmm.
This is for 7/21.
Okay.
Okay, you got it. You got it.
All right, thank you, ma'am. 5 minutes.
Good morning, everyone. And we are going to proceed with our workshop. I first want to make sure that we have our quorum, which we do. And I'm very thankful for all board members showing up right on time. First, we'll start out with Superintendent Davis giving an overview of the legislative platform. And then, Superintendent Davis, I'll go over just a little bit of housework just so we can command an efficient meeting. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, first and foremost, thank everyone for the time to meet today to talk about our legislative platforms. You will see before that each of you have documents that identify not only the state legislative platform, but federal as well. And for the first time, we put together a city-county legislative push to show ongoing collaboration and joint movement as an organization. In these platforms, everyone that's here today have worked diligently to try to think differently. And historically, and I'm not saying this is in Hillsborough County, but historically throughout the state, we identify blanket legislative pushes that do not genuinely go back and ask for dollars to really help us with our initiatives, our projects, and our strategic plan. And so what you'll see today, and thank you for many board members that have helped through this process of structuring the legislative and state platforms and federal platforms. We put it in the Power Five that were recommended at our last retreat, so that we can really hang our hat on strategies that allow us to have great accomplishments on particular areas of movements. And those are literacy and closing the achievement gap. It's linked to school improvement in climate and culture, graduation and career workforce, along with STEM 21st century development, which we continue to do a really nice job in, and then operational excellence and fiscal responsibility. So you see there's a lot of asks that you may have seen last year, but there's a lot of new initiatives and asks for allow us to really address these Power Five areas so that we can really have some movement in the organization. So again, I thank the team for really thinking creatively in order to put a number of asks in front of you. We know that this list is pretty massive, but we wanted to be able to put everything on paper so the board can go through it and remove any items or strengthen items or add items that may be a priority for our organization moving forward as we strive to become a top tier school district within the state of Florida.
Thank you, Superintendent Davis, and thank you, staff, for commanding such a wide berth of legislative items. At this time, we're going to go ahead into the state first. Secondly, we'll do the federal, and then last, we'll do the local. The state is the lion's share with, I think, around four pages. I hope that the board members had a chance to look over and make notations. What we'll do is we'll have a time certain of 3 minutes for each of us for the state. However, because there's so many, we'll probably have to queue up again, which that means you'll press your buzzer again, your light. I believe Pablo has shared how to do so. When you begin speaking, when you get to 2 minutes and 30 seconds, I'll say final thoughts, and this way we can manage a lot of information in an efficient way. Thank you, board members, for your patience and for your objectivity that we begin this workshop, a very, very important one at that. At this time, do we want to hear from Kristen Davis at all, Superintendent Davis?
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, Ms. Davis, any updates that you would like to provide of our development, our strategic partnership, how we will move through our partners with lobbyists in order to create movement once the board identifies the overall platforms?
Thank you. Thank you, Superintendent. Thank you, Chair and board members. Good morning. Thank you for this opportunity. Really excited to go through these legislative platforms with you. We know it's, as Ms. Gray said, it's a lot of information, but we hope that it's something that you find useful, that you find exciting, and things that we can wrap our arms around. We know that these platforms will serve as a guiding document for your work, your advocacy. So our next steps after we narrow these priorities down, we narrow down the items, we make them priorities, then we'll be to work with our contracted lobbyists to be able to sign items and really get to work, look for bill slots, and prepare for the interim committee weeks as well as the legislative session, which starts on March 2nd. So
thank you.
I won't take any more time.
Thank you, Kristen Davis. So at this time, board members, if you would like to press your button and get online for speaking on suggestions, deletions, concerns on the state legislative platform, this is a good time to press your button. You're already forgiven. Okay, so Stacey Hahn, Member Hahn will be first. Okay, Member Hahn, begin.
Thank you. So there's a number of appropriations asks in this list. What is the date where those forms are due to the legislature for appropriations asks?
The bill slots are already starting to go right now, so we do need to work quickly in January, or the dates are different for the House and the Senate. Obviously, the Senate has unlimited, Senate members have unlimited bill slots, but House members are limited to 7. So I want to say it's the January 29th, I believe, for the House, but for the to file a bill. But we, of course, need to do it, quickly.
Yes, I would say. So since we have some new, a few new board members, I think that maybe they've not been, I don't know the extent to what y'all have been involved in this process before, but if we could get some copies of the one-pagers and details on every appropriations ask that you're going to submit to the state.
Of course. So once we probably prioritize and narrow down today, then create one pagers and infographics on each one.
Yes,
absolutely. That's part of the.
I'd like to see actually the forms that you're submitting that require all the details spelled out for each ask, and then who is going to champion that at the state level for us. That would be really helpful. And once we narrow it down today.
And to your point, what Dr. Hahn is speaking about is that each, for those of you, I know you probably already know this, but for the House and Senate, they require a appropriations request form. And of course, the House and Senate forms are not the same, so you have to do 2 different forms. And actually new in the House this year, for the form, we actually have to certify that what the information we are submitting is all accurate, and that they could, it's a very interesting process. So we have to be very specific. So if you're asking for $540,000, you have to explain how exactly this will be used and why.
Right, and that's what I'd like to see, just for my own edification. So when I'm asked by press, or when I speak to somebody in our legislative delegation, I would just like to be able to educate myself on, and I'm sure the other board members would also want to be up to speed on the details of those asks. So I know we have a lot of work to do today, but moving forward, that would be valuable information. So thank you, Ms. Davis. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Member Hahn. Now we'll hear from Member Snively. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you, Madam Chair. We're starting, and I apologize if I missed this. Are we just starting with the city and council?
The state.
Or the state?
We're
starting with the state one.
Yeah.
Okay, because I have some city and council, so I'll come back then. I'll get back in the queue. I thought we were starting with the city and council platforms. So.
Okay. Any other board members want to speak on the state? Member Vaughn? So what we're asking for is any deletions, corrections, comments on those ones that we see, which is about 4 pages.
Mm-hmm.
I have a lot of comments, but I can't speak till the last, so I'm just going to wait till you all share. Feel free to share whatever thoughts, and Kristen will make note of it. This is not a perfect document. She's aware of that. So is our superintendent. So it's our job to see that the wording and all the nuances are what you all would like to see.
And then as far as the narrowing down process, when we're narrowing them down, that we'll have a chance to speak on that again, or this is our opportunity right at this moment to narrow it down?
This is our opportunity now.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Member Vaughn. Okay, Member Snively?
Okay, so a couple things. I would like to see side by side the FSBA platform, mm-hmm. because I don't have that right in front of me, but I think it's important that and FADS and HASA and all the other partnerships that we have with other organizations, I think it's really important that we have a unified front when going to speak with our legislators, so that Even though this school district probably has some unique needs that we will delineate from the other platforms, I think it's important to see what is on the other organizational platforms so that we know who's talking about what and why. And so if we could get that information available to us, I think that's really important.
So kind of envisioning like a packet to what Dr. Hahn said and to what you said, a whole packet with not only our information, but also...
Yes. If you want to put those in the packet, that would be fine. So, thanks. Miss Gray handed me the platforms that, ironically, I handed out to her last week. So,
I'm a saver.
Thank you for saving those. Mm-hmm. Then the other thing is to Miss Vaughn's point. I think with all of the platform items, and I know we don't have all morning, but I think it's important to kind of understand the rationale behind each of the platform items, and we can go down line by line or bullet point by bullet point.
Absolutely.
And then we can decide which ones are the most important to us. We know that when legislators entertain us by, you know, having an appointment with us in their offices, they really need to know the top, you know, three priorities, I think. And so all of these can be priorities, but I think when we go in to talk to our legislators, we want to have like the top three, because then we don't want anything to get convoluted with other priorities, and they're going through quite a bit, right? They're very busy. They're going 90 to nothing 24/7, and I think it's important for us to narrow it down to the most. Maybe that's what we can do today. Maybe we can say, okay, these are our top three or our top five that we want to make sure that we get in front of them to talk about. So anyway, so those are just my comments for now.
Yep.
Just weighing in. So I had a question. When we have this list, Superintendent Davis, are we able to integrate this with our strategic plan? So, you know, for example, page one, state accountability system. So maybe we can have a reference point.
Yes, yes, ma'am, through the chair, absolutely. This is, you know, the overarching theme of this is to look at the Power Five and to be able to incorporate those elements and attach actual legislation and movement in coordination with those. So I do not disagree with Ms. Snively. We've got to figure out and drill down to areas that we can hang our hat on and say we really want to champion to the finish line. And while I would love to take this entire packet, I think it gets lost. But more importantly, I just wanted our team to really show our thinking and our needs to be able to present to the board so we can help, you can help us, and to be able to drill down, to be able to figure out what's prioritized, what's most important, and what we think we can get our biggest bang for our buck as we seek to evolve the system.
And I also agree to start prioritizing with the amount of items is probably very much recommended. Question. As I go through this, and I know I have a certain amount of time, so I'll have to get back into the queue, but when we talk about STEM in various areas, such as page four, where it says, the last one on page four, pursue appropriation funding for the Arts and Innovation Academy at Madison Middle, and there's other references, but one of the emphases I think we all want to share is on arts, so can we not... And this is just putting it out there. Can we not exchange STEM for STEAM, and that would be science, technology, engineering, arts, and then mathematics?
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, we absolutely can. We see a major movement with that centralized focus, and we think that they interact nicely with each other. So that's no problem for us. We can expand that and make certain that the arts is performing visuals actually engaged in it along the way.
Okay, and one other question for now. Page one, the one right before the last point, pursue appropriation funding for Hillsborough County Public Schools Summer Bridge Program. I'm not sure of that, what that is. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so through the chair, the biggest thing is when we talk about literacy and closing the achievement gap, especially now during the pandemic, we've got to find innovative solutions to help our children compete. For me, a summer bridge would be really nice from second grade to third grade, as third grade there in the summer. And then, you know, because third grade is one of the major gatekeepers for retention. also from fifth grade, from elementary to middle school, and from eighth grade, middle school to high school, to have that summer bridge, to have that continuity, to be able to give children confidence, allow them to help with better organizational skills, expose them to literacy and math, to be able to combat summer learning loss. So being able to ask for appropriations to be able to continue the extended. We know that we have ESSER grant funding that we may provide additional amendments to be able to leverage this. But this is an ask that goes nicely with trying to work in Hillsborough County to close the achievement gap.
Well, very much needed. Thank you. And I also appreciate you putting the fiduciary, the amount of money that it would cost us should this happen. So that was very helpful. Okay, next we will have Member Snively?
No.
Oh, Member Perez. Sorry. Member Perez, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm a little confused. I thought we were going page by page, but
we can do that.
We're jumping around. Okay. So on page 3, under continuous school improvement and climate and culture, I'd like Dr. Vera Tirado to speak to the amend statute to specify that excuse absences that we spoke about last year. We presented it passed in the House, didn't pass in the Senate, but we're presenting it again, especially right now during this time of COVID. We've seen how the mental health supports are really needed, not just in Hillsborough County, but throughout the state of Florida, if you don't mind.
Yes, thank you. And appreciate your championship for continued support for mental health. And so, as you mentioned, there was an ask to look at basically elevating mental health and mental health needs to the same level as physical health, so that when absences are considered excused in Florida, that it doesn't just refer to physical health or illness in statute, but it also includes mental health. And so this recommendation, it's cost neutral, doesn't cost any money, but it sends a strong message that mental health is equally as important to physical health. And then it will also, as it changes in statute, will allow school boards to consider implications for policy, including some of the work that we've been interested in. I know you've worked with the superintendent on doing some pilot type of work, but we really need to focus on the statutory changes, as we've discussed, and this will get us a step closer to that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So a couple questions as I'm digesting some of this. One, do we have any legislators that we're working with right now on any of this, any of these platform items? Is there anybody ready to file a bill or any commitments on any of these
bullets? No specific commitments. We're waiting in the wings until the board absolutely came with their priorities, because we didn't want to jump too far ahead on anything that the board didn't establish as a priority.
Okay. So that leads me to my next question is, all of us have different passions for different parts of this legislative platform, right? There are things in here that I'm like, oh, definitely want that, mental health, literacy, all the things that we all have passions for. But what I think we need from you, Superintendent, is what do you think should be the most important items for us? We need to know what you think is going to align with the strategic plan for this school district, because I can tell you what's important to me, and Ms. Perez can tell you what's important to her, and Ms. Combs can tell you what's important to her, and that's already at least seven different priorities. So from you, tell us what do you need us to go to our legislators and say, hey, Representative Beltran, I need you to file a bill for this.
Right. So through the chair, the biggest thing, we can start on page 1 with the state. And I think the major right now for us is the first bullet, is to hold school districts and schools harmless related to the accountability system. to make certain that while we understand we need to have students need to take assessments, we, you know, right down during a pandemic, no one cares about school grades. The state has already come out and ran simulations that we'll have more DNFs in Hillsborough County and other school big urban school districts. So overall, while we will need information for student assessments to determine what interventions, how we create master schedules, how we determine our overall effectiveness of return on investment of curriculum, I think that one should be a major place for us to eliminate school and.
And that would be a Representative Latvala ask, probably, right?
Right, the chair of the education in the House, yes.
Yes, ma'am. At the same time, I think that, if we're openly going to, for us, and I look at the achievement gap, I think the summer ask for summer bridges is major for us to address the achievement gap, to have that continuity. And I just have it for major transitions from elementary gatekeeper of third grade, middle school to high school. But it could be for every school student that is, struggling, who are one or more years behind from a literacy and mathematic perspective. To have additional funds. I know we have ESSER funds, but in a school district as large as ours, within the placement we were with supplemental materials, with looking at whether we had digital needs, looking at the large scale of PPE, we weren't able to really leverage a lot of this funding to be able to close the gap, to have continuation or extended opportunities for learning for our children. We did have some money that we were able to use to the gears through transformation, but being able to have additional funding for continuation of summer learning at scale. We've always used around, I think, $4 to $5 million annually for summer school for students for grade recovery and course recovery, and we only do it for particular grades. But now more than ever, I would say that we have to expand that.
Can you tell me what page?
I'm sorry. Through chair, it's for page one. Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Six.
I need to make sure that.
Okay, board members, I will recognize you accordingly so we can have an efficient board meeting. I do want to say that, Superintendent Davis, I'm in sync with Member Snively that as board members speak, your priorities are critical, obviously, and the strategic plan, we know that has to be integrated as well. So with that being said, we're going to go ahead and move Member Snively, because we're on a I'll put you back in the queue. Yeah. And Member Hahn.
I'm sorry. I'm so used to everything being
right that. I'm sorry, was the superintendent done going through his priorities?
He went through page one, but if you are okay with that, Member Hahn, I'll let the superintendent continue before you speak.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I think it's important for him to identify. Yes.
Okay.
This, because I don't want the.
Okay, continue.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so very much, Ms. Hahn, and thank you, Mrs. Vaughn as well. If I go to climate and culture with continuously school improvement, climate and culture, the first two bullets for me are truly major. The first bullet is, prioritizing the district to, school district personnel, employees, in particular students, to have accessibility to the vaccine. We know that essential workers such as healthcare should be on the forefront of this. But being able to, with teachers, putting themselves in the situation every single day, I think that's something that we could hang our hat on and advocate for. And this would be at the will of the educator and also the parents. And then at the same time, I do agree with Mrs. Perez, and that we have to be able to figure out how we can try to, get statutory requirements changed to be able to address excused absences for physical and mental health. That's a major priority. And then also, I know it's a lot in this area, but we also want to develop, there's a, 9 states in this nation develop initiatives to further support military families through the Purple Star School Destination Program. And I think that, you know, we have a really solid military base here in Hillsborough County, and I think we could push to be a part of that initiative where it allows us, this program allows us to have and address and connect students to educational platforms, parents as well, to provide ongoing services. And this could, for us to be an advocate for the Purple Start School program to further support the academic and social emotional needs of military families. Under graduation and workforce development, one thing that, you know, being able to have a, you know, celebrate a really rich, diverse, you know, organization with our students. We know that we have a large number of students that are ELL learners within our organization. We need to understand that 90% of our ELL students, they make up, 90% of the certificates of completion within our organization. Every one of these students work hard. They have proper GPAs. The issue becomes is that they don't have the availability to take the state assessment in their native language. And I think it will be send a, you know, very clear, consistent message to our community that we care and we value who they are and their origin, that allow our ELL students and the other students to take the state assessments in their common native language throughout the year, at the end of the year for the state. I also think it's, going through with graduation and career workforce, I think there needs to be the first bullet on page 3. You know, right now, when we talk about the state continues to talk about how we want to have a longer, stronger bench of educators, and we agree with it. And I think the first two bullets go together. But if we're going to have a teacher pathway that allows our students to transition through the career of education, the state should allow our students to be able to take the general knowledge assessment within this pathway in this program. Why wait to enter college to be able to take it? We see, you know, this should be an industry certification exam that our students, like, you know, no different than our students take assessments, whether it's through CAD, digital design, whether it's you know, through brakes, automotive. This is no different. So allow our pathways of educators to take the general knowledge assessment, which you have to get within your first 3 years of teaching as an industry certification. And I think that allows our students to be able to validate, to compete, and create a pathway. And the second bullet is all about, you know, asking for additional funds to expand our teacher academy and allowing us to offer this at a K-12 continuum to exposure to, so we can start to continue to expand that pathway and grow our own. There's a major ask at the bottom of 3, asking for a innovative technical center in Plant City. We don't know if they'll give it to us, but it's a major ask. I don't know, but, you know, it's on there. And then if we look at STEAM, we can call it STEM, 21st Century Development. This is all about, this whole page on page 4, it's just all about expansion of initiatives, being very clear about ask. I do believe that there's an opportunity for us to seek money, and if it's the 1, 2, 3, the fourth bullet is about expanding, funding to, you know, we have a bill, you know, school coming up. Well, in the Southern County, there's really no, you know, STEM initiatives in the south of the county. So being able, we're going to build in 2022 Watershed K-8, and being able to attach money to Watershed K-8 that's directly linked to IB and science magnet academies allows us to provide attractive solutions, especially in that particular area where, let's be open, we have a number of choice, there's charter schools down there that are being innovative. We want to be able to compete, and this gives us an anchor within the southern part of the community to really allow us to do some innovative solutions through a science magnet linked to STEM, which is all about providing coding equipment, state-of-the-art technology, venues for our children, and being able to launch a school that has one-to-one devices to be able to meet the digital natives of where they are every single day. And then there's also one here that's explicit for ask for Madison. Madison is one of our schools that is 70, it's 70% at capacity. So we got to really figure out how to create a thriving, indirect ask. And that's to be able to partner with Lego and many other innovative solutions with 3D to be able to attract students openly. So, And then if we go to the operations excellence and fiscal responsibility, I think it's really a major ask. And we're really thankful for what Tallahassee did to help us with House Bill 641. But we need to find someone to sponsor and champion additional funding for veteran teachers. I commend this board for standing up for, you know, veteran teachers and finding funding to help us when, you know, $38 million was given to the Hillsborough County to disseminate to new teachers and early career teachers as well. But we've got to get to a point where we show value to be able to champion, you know, veteran teachers. And then as always, I think one big thing for us is to is all about transportation. I think it should be in here is for us to ask for our, and that could be at the federal level, to move the 2.0 to 1.5 for hazardous conditions. I don't know if that one's there, maybe on a different one that I put on.
Yeah, it was on there.
Okay.
Fourth bullet.
Yes, ma'am. Yep. I'd love to get PICO funds, but that's probably not going to happen. That's always ask. And I know it's a lot that we have on there. And one of the things, if you go to page 5, the last one, we historically, and Mr. Bunkley, you can help me, I think around $80 million is usually dedicated to digital classroom initiative and finances. We that money has depleted from millions and millions of dollars to Hillsborough County to I think around $154,000 that we have received this year, and this is all for us to be able to help address equipment, infrastructure, software on page 5, the last one, and to be able to restore the digital classroom allocation. And Mr. Bunkley, anything you want to highlight?
Just the fact that it's
But you need to find a microphone, please.
Sorry.
I apologize. I'll borrow Mr. McCulley's for a moment. There's a 96% reduction in technology funds during the age of COVID. That is questionable at best. The districts have been reduced from just under $4 million, as Mr. Davis said, about $154,000. It is hampering continued growth with technology.
Madam Chair, if I may for a moment, it's been brought to my attention that there's a discrepancy between what's online and your hard copy with the page numbers, and I think that's causing some confusion with the board. So I think there's a page 5, but then also on the page there's a 6 underneath that. So I think that's been causing some confusion at the dais, and so maybe when people are talking, they can be more specific about what page they're referencing. If you're looking at your hard copy, it creates some confusion. Online, it's clear, but on this is fine. So I think I would recommend if you're talking about page 5, use the page 5. Say page 5, is it, because here it looks like page 5 and page 6.
Thank you. Point taken.
And through the chair, those are, I think, some big ticket items. They're all so important, you know, but I know we've got to scale down, because I'd love for them to fund money for interventionists for every one of our underperforming schools. We have 43 sites that are DNF and lowest 300 schools within our school district, and that is on page 1. And that is the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's the 7th bullet. And this would be, you know, the ask would be around $6.5 million. I know it's a large ask, but if we're actually going to be able to move our underperforming schools in the age of COVID, in the time of COVID, and to move, we're going to have additional allocations related to interventions. And this is, you know, our teachers have got a lot on their plate to be able to identify literacy and mathematic interventions, to be interventionists to move forward into our schools, whether that's part-time or full-time. I think that would allow us to leverage results as well. But those are all for me, you know, big ticket items. And I know that there's some other areas that each of you may want to see and prioritize. And we're open and willing to make any adjustments we can.
Thank you, Superintendent Davis. And that was extremely helpful. Member Hahn?
Thank you, Member Gray. So there's a lot of appropriations on this, asks on this sheet, 7, 8 of them. And some of them, as you went through, I was looking at the growing our own teachers, the educator academies, which, you know, obviously we have had discussions about that, Superintendent. It's something that I tried to start in Hillsborough County when I was at the Anshin Center at USF. then engaged in more conversations as a first and second year school board member. So I appreciate the attention that you're giving to that conversation. But obviously all the STEM initiatives. But what I'm thinking when I look through this is some of these, as we as a board start to, you know, boil this down to a shorter list, some of these can be funded through corporate partnerships and don't necessarily have to be funded through appropriations, like the Educator Academies, like the summer magnet, the summer camp, cybersecurity summer camp. I mean, those things can be funded through private, community, corporate partnerships and don't necessarily need to be on an appropriations list. Because what this is, what the first time I looked at this, maybe a week or two ago when you shared it, it felt like a wish list, like a school board member wish list. And that's when I had the conversation with you about crosswalking it with the strategic plan and your buckets. And so I think when we're discussing this today and we're deciding on which ones do we need to actually move forward with at the state level, we need to think about, well, you know, could we accomplish this through community partnerships and corporate partnerships, which given COVID and the financial implications that have put on the state budget, we may actually have a better shot at funding through a different avenue. Not everything should that we need to accomplish needs to go through the legislature. So that's something I would just ask this board to consider, that if it doesn't make the appropriations list, we need to have a conversation on how we continue to fund that in other ways. Is that my time? Is that what that buzzer was? Okay. I'll get back in the queue. Oh, 20 seconds. I'll get back in the queue. I have a few more questions.
Member Hahn, I have to admit I was so immersed in your thinking, I lost track of time. Good points. Thank you. Member Gray? Oops. Yes. Member Vaughn, thank you. Thanks for your patience, Member Vaughn. I'm getting there.
Thank you. So my kind of thoughts on this as we're looking through this, as we're all talking about, this is quite extensive and it's hard to really narrow down things because they all seem important and things that we would, you know, personally want to advocate for. However, as we come onto the board and we really talk about the state of our finances, the ones that I'm really interested in are operational excellence and fiscal responsibility and really making sure that we're advocating to get as much money and support as we can from the state for our operational expenses. So I was wondering if Mrs. Davis could maybe talk to us a little bit more about a few of the ones that I have starred under that, if that's possible. Is that possible for her to talk to us? And just maybe get an understanding of holistically how they would help us and how that pertains to the amount of money that we get from Tallahassee. So the first one would be on page 5. I'm assuming that's the right page. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or actually, I'm sorry, the third one. There's maintain an increase in state education funding, then also the fourth and also the fifth. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about that.
Absolutely. So, you know, thinking behind the third item was really to, we talk a lot about the BSA, the base student allocation, and having additional funding. We know that the DOE has proposed an increase of $10 in the BSA for the 2021 fiscal year. So this ask on here is basically to continue to maintain but also increase our funding. We know they're talking about, at the state level, cutting budgets. And the education budget has been specifically mentioned. So while we also want to ask for increased funding, we also want to ask to maintain the funding we have, but we want it in a flexible manner and the base student allocation. And we appreciate categoricals, absolutely the teacher salary categorical, but having it in the flexible pot also is to a great advantage. So that was the thinking behind that. I know Mr. Davis already spoke about the millage going, you know, it was brought down from 2.0 to 1.75 to 1.5 over the past, you know, so many years. And so we just like to get back to the 2.0. We can do that through the state. As you know, we've also talked about doing that locally. doing that through, you know, a voter referendum. So that might be something we seek if we know that this is not something that it has, that they have an appetite for at the state level, which is more than likely. And I know you know that, Member Vaughn. And then, of course, PICO. Over the years, you know, PICO dollars, originally we received a lot of those many years ago tied to landline phones, and it's decreased over the years considerably. And so now it's written into legislation just that the money goes directly to really charter schools. And you can see that they received $169.9 million, while the state hasn't. The last time we received any PICO dollars was in 2008. So, absolutely.
Thank you, Member Vaughn, and we'll go right off to Member Gray. Just real quick, I will say in response to Member Snively's request to prioritize and thanking Superintendent Davis for doing so, I'm just giving my input as to priority as I'm thinking through this. I did study this document quite a bit. So just to share this in hopes that it may help board members also join in prioritizing these asks. Financially, and I'm dividing it into financial literacy, safety, the commonalities of platforms. Financially, in my mind, teacher salaries is critical for veteran teachers. Literacy. And Member Hahn knows so well that before we can do a whole lot of teaching, the children must read. Instruction, technology is critical, and the money for it, we're way behind, and we know that. Schools are wanting to be STEM, STEAM, and all that, but we don't have, matching technology. Safety. I do believe the future will hold an opportunity for our nurses to absolutely give out the vaccines as we are going forward. I would like to be thinking of that, and I see that is in there as well. And last, we need the money. Our district has to have a restoration of monies. Whether we go restore it from the 2008 millage, which I think I have down here is, hold on a second. Oh, dear. Well, Kristen, you know it by heart. I believe the 2008 was, well, at any rate, I'll get back to it. But the idea of the ask in the future is necessary, and be it through millage or, I hate to use the word tax, referendum. We all know that in Colorado, they had that tax on marijuana, and Colorado has so much money, they don't know what to do with it. In Orange County, you know, they did it on entertainment. So there's all kinds of eclectic ways, and but we have to do something. So what priorities are coming to my mind after studying the document that you handed us, those are priorities that seem to light up. Thank you. Member Snively.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So very good points. I know that under the operational excellence and fiscal responsibility, I think we all feel very strongly about some of those bullet points that Member Vaughn pointed out. I think it's also important to hear from our lobbyists, from the firms that we partner with. I know J.D. White is here from Shoemaker, and I was wondering if, I hate to put him on the spot, but I was wondering if you could come up and talk a little bit about some of the, what are some of the, your opinion, in your professional opinion, what are some of the more realistic bullet points? Because some of these are non-starter conversations, right? We know that. We ask every single year, and I think we should continue to ask. We're not going to stop asking, but I know that some of these are non-starters, that even if we ask, it's probably not going to happen. Can you kind of tell us what are our best chances here on some of these bullet points with what you know and what you're seeing as legislative priorities from the state legislature coming up in 2021?
Sure thing. And I'll try my best.
Okay.
So through the chair, J.D. White with Shoemaker Advisors, you know, in general, we've all heard about kind of the fundraising or the funding problems that we have at the state level. So I would say that if you're talking about policy initiatives, those are going to be finding our champions in the legislature. So you've already mentioned a few, but local champions. When it comes to funding, some of these are going to be big asks. And so we have to be realistic about the big ass. But working with the governor's office and Department of Education on things we can do through rulemaking, policy initiatives that we can work with local legislators that don't have a price tag, and then being very specific about our needs on the appropriations. So I think it's a mix, but you know, if I were to go through some of these, the higher the price tag, kind of the higher the priority it has to be, and we have to know that we're going to give up on some of the others. So it's just this judgment and this mix of what we actually think are the highest priorities. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. And I appreciate your insight. And I'm guessing that you and Gray Robinson, maybe Kim McDougal from Gray Robinson, right, will kind of guide us on which legislators are going to best fit which priorities when it comes to policy and appropriations.
Sure. And so the other thing I just talked a little bit about earlier, I mean, we can align our priorities with other school districts, other asks that are happening statewide. So we can essentially, we can have them, those folks work on some priorities that are the same as ours, and then we focus in on what is specific to Hillsborough County. What is gonna best benefit our student achievers? And, you know, so we focus in on what's specific to the district. Then we'll work with a coalition around priorities that are good for our region and are good for our state. So it is really this mix of ingredients that go into the final product. Does that make sense?
Yes, and so that's why I had mentioned the Florida School Board Association priorities, right, too, because you'll see on those priorities what other school districts are all asking for, some of the same things that we're asking for, right? And so today is the object of today, or the objective today, to kind of narrow it down to get to, okay, these are the ones that we're going to ask for. Is that what I'm hearing? And
yes, ma'am.
When we leave today, the ones you've highlighted, maybe we talk about those, and then any others that you didn't highlight,
correct,
that we need to decide on which ones to put to the top of our priority list.
Yes, Mr. Chair, exactly right. And anything that, even if I highlight them and we don't think that merges with us or we can accomplish it, we can remove it. We just need to get a list so we can continue to work with JD and his team and others and Greg Robinson to really figure out what we can actually get to the finish line. And I do like the part where if someone else is going to champion it, then, you know, we can be an advocate from behind the scenes and let us do some explicit stuff for Hillsborough County. Hence the reason you see some initiatives that are directly linked to our schools and being innovative and creative. And while these can be legislative pushes, I think there's other avenues that we can go to create the ask as well, to get people to champion it, to get to the governor's desk. I'm willing to make that a priority.
And board members, I'll remind you that because this is a workshop, you don't actually vote at a workshop. I think if there's some consensus that's arrived at, this will be on your agenda this afternoon if you need to have a vote and specifically give direction or give a hard sort of list of what you want. But I think the goal this morning is to hear from your staff, hear from your lobbyists, and give them some direction through consensus. Again, so we should not anticipate a vote this morning, but you should, the more guidance you can give to them, I think the better.
Okay, thank you, Mr. White. We appreciate you being here today. And also, maybe we can, if we could get a copy of the school board, can we get some copies made of this? That,
yes, ma'am.
Fortunately,
yes, ma'am.
Unless, does anybody else need a copy besides me for the Florida School Board Association? Okay, thank you. That way we can kind of align and see what's already on that list, and then pick a few from that are important to Hillsborough County and add those to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Member Snively. Member Vaughn?
Yeah, I'm
Thank you. I appreciate you holding this workshop today so we can talk about these things. And while I hear what you're saying, and I denote to your expertise when it comes to legislation about prioritizing some items that directly respond to Hillsborough County and allowing other counties to kind of do the heavy lifting on some of the items that we share, I disagree with that approach. I think that we need to collectively have a voice about some of these issues that affect us all, especially when we come back, and I know it's going to be a heavy ask, but when we come back to advocating for more money from the state for the needs that we have, you know, across the board. So I guess my question would be, if we were kind of talking about the three that I highlighted under the operational excellence and fiscal responsibility, kind of understanding if we had to prioritize one of those threes, which would have the biggest impact financially to helping us out, would be one of my questions. As well as I want to make sure that when we're having this conversation, we're not talking about the school improvement, climate, and culture that has a lot of direct relation to COVID specifically policies. And I know we talked about making the vaccine accessible, which I think is fantastic and should be a priority, and I think that's something we can all agree on. But I also want to talk about, again, when we're talking about seeking additional relief funding, that's a second one that talks about making sure that we have enough funding to prioritize the response that we're going to have to COVID and making sure that we keep everybody safe and prioritizing that. So I want to make sure that we talk about that. But from my understanding, I just want to clarify, while we might be highlighting things today that we want to really focus on and be great advocates for, this entire list is just something that we were planning on passing to say this is what we'd like to prioritize just at some point in general. So is there a value to removing things from it? Just so I can understand the process. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, let me clarify. I do agree that there's going to be major platforms that we're going to link with SBA, FADS, we're going to link with FASA. I mean, we're going to link with HASA, all those platforms. There are going to be about three or four that we're all going to link together. But there's some in the middle that, JD spoke about, that we're going to have to let other school districts deal with and then be very explicit. So the top tier foundation, you're right, we have to be advocates and they'll go together. But there's going to be middle areas that we should let others kind of get to the finish line that aren't our big tickets, that we can really focus on what we want to do at Hillsborough County. As it relates to this document, my hope was going to be able to identify, to prioritize this list, to kind of drill it down to be able to bring it this evening for a vote on the agenda. However, I mean, we still can, to your point, Mrs. Vaughn, we still can bring the entire list to accept if the board is the willing of the board, and then we can continue to champion some of those elements, knowing that our priorities may be a little bit different in scale, and that those are the ones we're going to be able to give the one pagers and work with our lobbyists to be able to truly be our anchors for the year. So either way, I'll take direction from the board to let us be able to get to that point.
Thank you, Superintendent Davis.
Just so you know, I yield the rest of my time.
Oh, thank you, Member Vaughn. Member Hahn, next.
Thank you, Member Gray. So you identified and highlighted 11. You boiled it down to 11. Can you give me your top three out of those 11?
Oh, top three is so hard to do. The biggest thing I'd say is to be able to, I mean, I think that we should, well, I can work on school grades on the side. So is it a priority of ours? It should be, but I can work on that on the side through other organizations for removing grades, so I can remove that one. I think that Summer Bridge is major for us to find additional funding for Summer Bridge to address the achievement gap as a continuous, learner and making certain we address children. I also believe that that we should really focus on allowing, I think mental health continues to be a major, component for us. We already have someone that's willing to sponsor that bill to get it to the finish line for mental health. I think, I don't know if it's a top four. I think students who are ELLs ought to be able to take their assessment in their native language. And I'm sorry, I'm going through these. And I think we ought to, you know, under the operational excellence and fiscal responsibility, I think we ought to champion for veteran teachers, and I think we ought to ask for additional money on the BSA.
And then give me two or three additionals to the to your top three.
I'd love for us to expand a STEAM initiative with going after on page four. It's the to pursue a additional you know science magnet K-8 IB arts at the Watershed K-8 to be able to compete. I think we have to do something in the southern part of the county.
I would agree. There's a heavy competition down there. Which
major.
Thanks.
And then let me give you. I think the vaccine we can work on our on the backside of that and doesn't have to be a pro. We'll make it a priority for movement. But so, but I, you know what? I'm gonna say that. Well, I keep going back to school improvement because it's a big part for me. I'd love for us to be able to. I wish they would ask for interventionists for our underperforming schools. Any schools that are, if we're really going to close the achievement gap, and we have a number of schools that are DNFs and the most DNFs in our state and also the lowest 300, we should ask for additional supports and interventionists to be able to address the achievement gap.
Okay. And I appreciate that. The reason I ask is that, you know, we know that everything on this list is important.
Final thoughts?
But, okay, Ms. Gray, thank you. Oh, I can see.
Sorry. That. Through the chair, I took a lot of your
he
time.
He took a
I'm
lot
sorry.
Of my time.
I'm sorry.
So, you know, I really think we need to have a very tight plan going up to Tallahassee. We can't go up there with four pages of asks. We're not going to end up with anything. And again, I go back to just because we may take some things off of this legislative platform, it doesn't mean we cannot continue to work on that funding in different ways, whether it's through partnerships or grants. So I just think, again, that's why I'm kind of pushing you to really, you know, boil this down to three top priorities and two or three additionals that we can really build a robust plan around to get what we need to get things across the finish line. This can't be throw everything at the wall and let's see what sticks. That approach is going to fail, and we will walk away with nothing.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Member Hahn. Member Combs?
I was going to say the same thing. I thought maybe we would bring down, we have 32 items right now. I thought maybe to have a dozen or something like that. And possibly when we're looking at the STEAM, maybe putting them together. You know, you're looking at an entire page, and maybe instead of just really individualizing all of these, maybe combining some of these together so that way it can be one representation of how we want to increase in the STEAM program. And fundamentally, I'm really looking at third grade and what third grade is really going to look like. I mean, should it be third grade or really second grade when you're looking at our children who are going to be very behind phonetically throughout the state and throughout the county? I think we kind of need to, instead of just focusing on third grade, what do you think about focusing on the younger elementary years? Because we are looking at children who've been out of school for maybe a year, year and a half, who are going to be quite behind.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I think it's a good point. It's a part of a conversation we need to have. And the reason we put third grade, because third, you know, third grade is the major gatekeeper, and that is the start of the retention year. And third grade, you know, pass rate proficiency, as you know, that's how they determine how many gel, you know, cells to create, build, how many beds they need. And also it's a determination of how one will overall be successful as they transition through education. So I do believe we got to do, but you know, continue to expand it in a primary manner. Second grade is a major as well. So, you know, holistically, this ask was all about being able to reduce the class size for grade three to have, greater accessibility to students. And it's such a major year, but two is also major. I don't disagree that it could be a part of the conversation.
And would it be to look at maybe having two forms, having the dozen that we're trying or whatever number that we have that we're trying to focus on, and then on the backside, having something that has the other legislative platforms that we're trying to go out to the communities and to areas to try to get some of that support from. You know, really looking, because when I look at this, it just looks like there's so much involved. I think that we really need to tone it down to maybe a dozen and then keep the other key points that we are trying to strive towards and making sure we place it on the side so that way we don't forget and that we continue to go back around and touch base with those.
Thank you, Member Combs. And we will have to be very mindful that we have an hour left, and we also have federal and local. So we're going to go ahead and finish with the speakers that are showing up, and the board members, that is, and then we're going to go to federal as we will need to. The workshop will end at 11:30 prompt, and so we're going to be very mindful. Thank you. I just wanted to say real quick, I put myself in line because I didn't want to forget that one of the priorities should be mental health. And I apologize, Member Perez, because I know that is critical. And diversity, paying attention to the diverse populations. So I just didn't want to go on the record to have forgotten those priorities. And I do agree with Member Hahn that we do need to get narrowed down to 3 to 5 priorities. Okay, let's go ahead next. Member Snively.
Thank you, Member Gray. Okay, so everyone should have a copy of the FSBA Legislative Priorities Platform. Mm-hmm. There are 6 main objectives on that.
School board member for District 7, countywide, and you're watching Hillsborough Schools TV.
The students from the modeling and simulation class and the APCSP class are designing and putting together the ornaments that we're going to be delivering to Sullivan Elementary. We just felt that we wanted to do something, you know, for the
less emphasis on asking for funding, right? Okay, and so those are bullet number one, on page one, bullet number one, which aligns with the FSBA. Bullet number on page two, under continuous school improvement, climate culture, bullet number one and bullet number two and bullet number four. Under graduation rate and career workforce development, bullet number one and bullet number two on page three. And then on page 5, bullet number 1, under operational excellence and responsibility. And those all align, most of those align with the FSBA. The ones that can be achieved through appropriation, which I think I said those were 6 different ones, right, by statute. So appropriations on page 1. Pursuing appropriation, that's bullet point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Bullet point number 9, pursuing appropriation for the Summer Bridge Program. On page 3, the last bullet point, pursue appropriation funding to build a technical center. I think that could be a possible appropriation that maybe Representative McClure could champion. On page 4, bullet 1, 2, 3, number 4, it could be an appropriation as well. And on page 5, under operational excellence, possibly the last bullet point, maybe. I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen statewide, but maybe we could ask for an appropriation for Hillsborough County, right? So that would be my recommendation, would be to go with those items to narrow it down to the most important priorities. They will align with the FSBA platform, but they also have a few appropriations and policies that could help and support Hillsborough County strategic plan initiatives. Thank you.
Thank you, Member Snively, for doing a lot of the work, and that was excellent. Thank you very much for capsuling it. Now, next is Member Perez.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So, yeah, I agree with Member Snively. Under the FSBA, and thank you so much, Member Snively, for providing us this document. Under invest in the success of Florida's students, invest in the safety and health and health learning environments and pause the negative consequences, right there in those three areas are your three top asks. You know, but the way they encapsulate it, it's very, very to the point. But on two and three, basically there's no funding really ask if you develop it correctly. The way that we're doing the mental health is just as a legislative follow-up from something that we did last year. And that would benefit the entire state, not just Hillsborough County. But then the pause the negative consequences of accountability system, that's also something that is not a financial ask as well. But and then the first one, investing in the success of our students, would be the only ask on that three bullet point. But basically, that's what your ask is, and according to the FSBA. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Member. Thank you, Member Perez. Member Vaughn, and then we'll go to federal.
Thank you so much. I guess I'm just a little bit confused about what we're really talking about here. When we talk about narrowing it down, and we're saying prioritize, we're picking the ones that we want to prioritize, does that mean that when we get this later to pass, this is going to be a different document? Or are we saying this document is going to be the same, and that's what we're going to prioritize when we look out of this document?
So through the chair, you know, we can do two ways. So we would historically take all the asks and compile and bring to the board a very explicit ask that the board had, you know, through feedback today, we'd bring to the board for the board to review. So, or if the board desires for this, all of it to review, to take all of this to the board for approval, along with a separate page, or, you know, a separate document that says these are the most prioritized elements that we will go forward, I can do either or. So I'll wait for the direction for the board. But historically, we would drill it down, and the ones that the board would approve would be the actual 12 or 10 elements that were agreed upon.
And you know what? Member Snively has a clarification.
Okay, I just want to make sure that this doesn't take away from my time.
It won't. No, I'm watching the watch.
So generally what we have done is, very good question, by the way, because there's a lot on here, a lot of priorities. So generally what we have done is we've taken the top ones that we have consensus and put them on a first page, like it just kind of similar to the FSBA, just a one pager. And then the rest of them can be attached underneath it, and with talking points. And so they're all our priorities, but we drill it down to maybe five or six that go on a top page, and that's what we focus on. But we give everything to the legislator and saying, these are all of our priorities, but we're going to talk about maybe the top five or six, not to overwhelm them. And especially if they are in relation to a bill that's been proposed. This, I will, the caveat on this is a living, breathing document, and it changes every week because, you know, as you know, the bills going through committee change, they get amended, they don't get through committee, whatever the case is. But I think administratively, what you're asking is, you know, those ones that we have consensus on today will go on like a one pager, and then everything will go underneath it.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is that this document will still stand when we have a meeting later today. We're not paring down this physical document. This conversation is just to prioritize. So I appreciate that clarification. I guess my thought process would be, as much as I appreciate us all having input on this process and being transparent about it and talking about it so the public can follow along legislatively, you know, we have people that we've hired to help us kind of manage this. So as it's important for us to advocate for what we think is important, what I imagine their job is to do is to take this list. And as you say, as it's a living document, as things change and legislatures pass, they come back and they say, okay, well, originally you wanted to prioritize this one, but this one is the one that's really getting a lot of support. And so, you know, I feel like,
they're kind of doing the work that we're doing right now. That's what we've paid them for and whatnot. So I just want to make sure, because I did contribute some to this, that the things that I have contributed and that maybe not necessarily the priority of the superintendent or everybody collectively isn't removed from this document, and that as legislation changes, we have the ability to revisit our priorities and talk about them as they change. So you help clarify that for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Member Vaughn. Very good points. And I think if we are okay as a board, we can move right on to the federal, which thankfully is a little bit less of a read. And Superintendent Davis, I think that in the same venue that issued and suggested, perhaps you can share your priorities on the federal level as well. So yes, we can cut some time off. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, this is a two-page document and not a five. So here we try to be very explicit and once again take the recommendation of the big buckets. The first one I would say is a major priority for us is the under literacy and closing the achievement gap, is really allow us to ask the federal legislation to increase the funding for IDEA and Title III. As you know, we continue to have the declining number of shortage of ESE teachers. So what this funding is really truly ask, it is a financial ask for us to provide supplements for ESE teachers, to incentivize them to stay in these positions, to be able to address the shortage, but at the same time be able to work with students every single day who need us the most. Under climate and culture, in the second bullet, the second and third bullet are really, really extremely important for our work. The second one is all about, for climate and culture and school improvement, is about asking for a second round of CARES Act funding. We know that we did get $68 million holistically through Hillsborough County that we have shared with that, with other education providers. But being able to bring in a second wave to really help us continue to address the physical mental health screening of our students, to continue to provide the necessary PPE for our students as this will potentially continue until the vaccine truly hits is really validated within our community. And then continue to make certain that we have ongoing funding to further support free meals. I know the federal legislation provided that for the remainder of this school year until funds are exhausted, but being able to make that holistically a commitment for the 21-22 school year, because I believe that the impacts that we have now of COVID will be systemic to 21-22. And this is why we're available to do some really monumental foundational work with being able to do summer, feeding our community during summer, and what we're going to do for winter break as well, to be able to bridge that gap, for our students with nutrition, and then making certain that we have the technology to be successful. And then, Tinker K-8 was on our, this was an initiative, my understanding, from last year. We are at capacity, and this is only available for students who are on base at sixth grade for six, we really need to be able to ask money, and it is there. We do have a we're working with the House to be in to be able to champion this. I've also been able to have multiple conversations with Senator Scott and Rubio to be able to champion this and to create the ask so that we can have additional funding for expansion of the K-8 at Tinker. Anything you want to talk about, Katie, from that side, from K-8?
I think that covers it. We are really excited about the movement with Tinker. We know that the House has brought forward in their defense appropriations bill $270 million. The Senate came forward with it zeroed out, but they are open to conversations. As Mr. Davis said, he has reached out in multiple venues and had conversations, and Senator Scott and Rubio are very supportive of this, as we know it would help Tinker as well as all the other bases in the state of Florida. So thank you.
Thank you. And under graduation workforce development, my hat's off to what Scott Brooks does in this particular area. This is a financial ask under the first wave. We do so much for apprenticeships with our community. Our adult education continues to thrive. We have so many of our constituents that, need pathways, need exposure to the workforce. And, while we're doing a really good job with our apprenticeships and our trades, we've got to have some additional funding to be able to market not only to students that are in our high schools, but also our community, to make sure that they are thriving, civic leaders and positive contributors. And this ask allows us to seek additional funding to have standardization of how we're going to market and educate them about what's out there through their apprenticeships. And then under Operation Excellence and Responsibility, this is the big, you know, the one ticket item is to continue to help our teachers in expansion with student loan forgiveness for all public education employees. And then the next two are all about making certain that we continue to fund education properly related to inflation. And the final one is if there's a possibility for additional funding or grant movements for community school grants. We know we have four right now that are involved in the National Education Association and two that are with UCF. And to figure out to be able to find particular areas within our community about how ongoing support services for developing the whole family can continue through our strategic partnerships.
Thank you, Superintendent Davis. And we'll begin with Dr. Hahn. Member Hahn, thank you.
Thank you, Member Gray. And with allow for flexibility of IEPs, could you expand a little bit on what specifically how that would look, be carried out within a district? What type of flexibility do you think we need in regard to IEPs?
So openly, we scratched that this morning. COVID has allowed us the emergency order has allowed us to somewhat be flexible, but we're really binded to be able to meet the needs and the services and provide intervention. So we scratched that this morning. We want to make certain we will continue to work through the emergency orders to provide supports to our children. So that's no longer for us an ask.
Yeah, because I just wouldn't want to see that opportunity to be taken as watering down anybody's IEP. We have to find ways to continue to honor those documents. The Tinker, I appreciate that being on here again. As MacDill has grown, that school serves families who live on the military base, and there's at such overcapacity. So if we could tap into some federal support to expand that school, that would certainly serve our military families well, who already sacrificed so much for our country. As in regard to the community schools, we now have four community schools, correct? Five.
Yes. Five. We have six. Yes,
ma'am.
Six.
Sorry. I know we grew them last year, the year before. Could we please see some impact data on those schools in regard to not just student achievement, but community impact data? Those schools are a huge investment. So I would like to see that data. It's never really been brought forth. I don't know if that even could be a workshop, maybe, where we really look at each community school, what they're delivering, to make sure there's, especially for our new board members, so they have a lot of them are in, you have Mort, I believe, and, a lot of us have them in our districts. Obviously, Member Gray and Member Perez have all of them. And I think just getting an update on the positive impact that they're making for our students and our community, as well as some of the challenges they're facing, would help, us better support those efforts. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Member Hahn. Very important ask that you just shared. Okay, so just real quick on my end, I agree, Superintendent Davis, with the first bullet point, support increased funding for the necessary supports and interventions because of the learning loss that our children have been faced in the families. I think that's a very critical ask. The interventions necessary. And I know the state has put together the plan, and we'll go over that during the school board meeting, but there is going to be a tremendous need for more and more interventions. Secondly, I keep on saying about the prioritized school district staff and students, as you mentioned, to access the COVID vaccine, simply because our teachers and our staff, principals, administrators, they're on the front lines every day, and I definitely want to outreach as much as we can. So I'm very much paying attention to that, as we all are probably. Third, greater accountability and instructional standards should be matched by our charter schools as well. So if we're doing all the necessary precautionary measures, safety, prioritizing STEM, I would like to also be able to ask and have a, we are going to have a workshop in April, that the charter school also matches that which we have. Every year is a different year for our legislative. So I want us to pay attention to that as well. And last, agreed about the workforce, very important to our state and our federal legislatives. There's money, there's opportunity, and I'm very much in agreement with the last the last bullet on the page where it says graduation rate and career workforce development. Those are my remarks, and I believe probably Member Snively's next. She'll get everything prioritized best as possible. Member Snively?
Thank you, Member Gray. So, okay, so looking at a comparison with the FSBA priorities, and the reason I put a great emphasis, I think everybody understands why I put a great emphasis on that. There's power and influence in numbers, and so when you have, you know, 67 school districts all saying the same thing, I think it's that speaks to some of the potential success of some of our platform items. But I agree with Dr. Hahn and Member Gray. These are all important priorities, all of these. It's hard to really narrow this down. Unfortunately, it is kind of a short list, so maybe we can just go with all of them. But three out of the four FSBA priorities do align with it. If you look at the federal priorities, number one, mm-hmm. number two, and number four are all in our priority plan as well. And sort of number three, which is funding for mental health services and addressing COVID, but not supporting the continuation of Medicaid reimbursement. So I wanted to ask Ms. Morgan, Carly Morgan, who's also here from Shoemaker, who does our federal, assists us with our federal advocacy, should we be adding that to our priority under operational excellence and fiscal responsibility as far as adding the support of the continuation of Medicaid reimbursements to school districts? Should that be added to ours?
It's certainly something you could consider doing. It, you know, that will come back to us through the state, but certainly it could be added to that piece on your agenda.
Okay. And then as far as the other priorities, most of them do ask for funding. Mm-hmm. And I would ask, would it be, in your opinion, your professional opinion, would it be is this too much, or do we need to narrow this down a little bit more?
So I would, you know, just like you're doing with the state, I would choose which things you think are your priorities, the things you most want to get done. Mm-hmm. Certainly your consultant team will help to make sure those are on the forefront, but and we can advise you as well on what things we think have the best chance as well.
Do you know what has the best chance now, or do you need to?
I can certainly tell you the things that I think the climate mm-hmm. right now suggests.
Or conducive to?
Yep, for mm-hmm. sure. Okay. So yes, the first being COVID stimulus, I think it is very, very, very likely that there will be another influx of funding through COVID stimulus at the federal level. In fact, a bill was just introduced yesterday that has bipartisan support. We don't know a lot of the details of that bill yet, so I apologize for that, but really just in this meeting, I was able to pull down some of the top line things. So there are $7.5 billion to governors. Now that goes to public schools, private schools, everywhere, right? And is dispersed by a funding formula to each state. It has $54 billion for K through 12 schools. Again, just like the last one, based on Title I numbers. Mm-hmm. And there's also $3 billion in the bill for access to broadband and devices and things like that. So those things kind of feed into some of the things you already have on there. Again, we don't know a whole lot about that bill yet, but I just wanted to give you that top line that I got now. So certainly COVID stimulus funding is a good idea for a priority. Tinker, I'm very hopeful that we're going to finish that this year. You know, the federal level is such a funny beast in that it's not like the state and it's all year. So, you know, I think it should remain on the list. But I'm very hopeful that we will see funds for that. Also, the student loan relief, I think that is also, that has been an ongoing conversation at the federal level that I think has some real possibility. And full service community schools are also getting some attention. So I think that could be another one you could.
Okay, so those are, so just to recap, that would be under section 2, under the continuous school improvement and climate and culture bullet point number 2, seek additional COVID funding relief for public school districts. Bullet point number 3, prioritizing Tinker 8. And then under operational excellence and fiscal responsibility, bullet number 1, supporting the expansion of student loan forgiveness, and number 3, with regard to community schools. And so as far as IEP and IDA and Title III, any of those?
So unfortunately, IDEA is one of those things that, like Title I, is just chronically underfunded. And certainly, there's nothing that they absolutely should be a part of it because they're so important. To your point about advocating with other groups, I think that the stronger the voice, the more movement you get on those.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So. I know I went over just a bit, but I neglected to mention bullet point number 1, 2, 3. It's actually technically bullet point number 3 under the first section, which is bridging that digital divide with technology.
And like I said, I think there could be some stimulus funding that could help with that.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
Yes, and thank you, Carly, for sharing the information. That's definitely helping us and Member Snively getting us organized. Member Vaughn.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And thank you, Board Member Hahn, for talking about the community schools and suggesting a workshop on that. I would love to see that. And I also appreciate that you included the community impact into that information and not just school grades, because it's a holistic conversation we need to have. So I love this list. You know, I think it is such a short list. I mean, I would love not to see it pared down, but if we're talking about things we want to prioritize, again, access to the vaccine and prioritizing that is going to be something that I think that we should do. It sounds like Tinker is in the works, and it's something that we should definitely keep on the list and has a lot of momentum behind it. I'm glad to hear that the student loan forgiveness is something that we're talking about. It might be on the horizon, because that's something that I definitely want to talk about prioritizing. And then again, you know, talking about increasing the funding. Some of the questions I would have is, if we do increase the CARES Act, you know, does that funnel through the state? Do they have additional control over how much we get of that? You know, does that fall back then on the legislation priority when we're talking about that? I also loved Mrs. Gray, this goes way back, but talking about accessing taxes from any kind of marijuana thing that gets passed. I know that's been really successful in other counties. And then I just want to kind of close by saying, while I understand we can't go and expect a ton of money and just ask for stuff that has price tags nonstop because we're going to get turned down, I also don't want to be afraid to advocate for more funding and more money and constantly have the concept of, are we asking for money? Because that's part of what we need to do, is advocate for the funds that we need. And I see that we're able to do that on the federal level a little bit more. And I don't want us to be afraid to do that on the state level as well, and get into that habit of saying, let's look for things that don't have a dollar note next to it, because we don't want to advocate for that. So I just wanted to kind of get that out there. And then if you could speak to the CARES Act, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So as you know, we received upwards of more than $68 million in different buckets through the CARES Act, through ESSERs, through you know, Rising Kindergarten Program. It was 11 different direct or indirect funding sources, grants, that the district received. And so, as Carly did mention, we are looking at a $908 billion stimulus bill that we're hoping that the one portion, the less controversial portion, that $748 billion, will trickle down to the states. So we will continue to keep you updated, as Mr. Davis has, with the CARES portion.
Thank you, Member Vaughn, and thank you, Ms. Kristen Davis. So if we're all ready, board members, we can go ahead and now start on the local, which I think is definitely the most exciting. We'll have probably a lot to say on that. That's, of course, it's not a page number. It says
Page.
Clarification, Member Snively?
Thank you. I just, I wanted to, because I think we're trying to get to some consensus on, you know, what bubbles up to the top. And so based on what Ms. Morgan suggested, are we good with that being like on the first page of a legislative priority sheet, but keeping everything else that's on here on a, you know, saying that they're all our priorities and let's keep them all as priorities? And are we okay including Medicaid reimbursements as one of the priorities, but just on the tippy top cover sheet, top priorities, the ones that Ms. Morgan mentioned, are we good with that? Or I just want to get it.
Yep. Member Vaughn, would you like to speak? And then following that, Superintendent Davis, can you go ahead and capsule what we're saying, because we need to get organized and know what we're going in, and then we'll start on the local. Member Vaughn?
Thank you very much for recognizing me, Madam Chair. I would just, could you remind me whether the vaccine was on the one that you had identified? I don't think that was on the list when you identified.
For the state, for the federal?
For the federal,
it wasn't, but we do, I do want to make sure everybody on the dais knows that Superintendent Davis is working, has a draft letter to go to the governor regarding the vaccine and prioritizing our educators. So we will, you know, start at the local level, but also share that with our congressional delegation at the federal level to keep them informed. And I did just want to jump in real quick that as far as federally, if you do decide to narrow it down to one, just to fewer, because we work so well closely with both Gray Robinson and Shoemaker, all of these we will advocate for. I can guarantee you that. And we keep a pulse on everything, and so they all will be advocated for.
Thank you. Member Hahn, and then we'll conclude with Superintendent Davis, and then we'll go to the local. Thank you.
Thank you, Carly, for speaking today, and I really appreciate your expertise, because I think the federal level, it's not something that we've traditionally focused on until Superintendent Davis came on board. So I appreciate that, because I think it was kind of untapped for many years. And so I think, you know, having your expertise and helping guide us a little bit as to what priorities we can get some movement on and focus on, I appreciate, and I would support those top four that you mentioned, and keeping the rest on the list as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Member Hahn. Superintendent Davis, would you like to share, just recap the priorities, just so we know exactly what we concluded with?
Yes, Madam Chair. I have to disclose that I had to go into the hallway for a little bit while Mrs. Carly was speaking, so I'm sure KD, you know, help me out through this.
Yes, we prioritize, thank you, Mr. Davis, thank you. For the four, for federally, that would be on the one-page summary. Under continuous school improvement, the second bullet, seeking additional stimulus funding. The Tinker K-8 is number two. Number three would be the extension expansion of student loan forgiveness. And then, of course, the fourth one, federal partnerships as far as grant opportunities in our community schools, full-service schools. Those would be the four.
And thank you, KD, which is now the emblematic symbol for Kristen Davis, so that's fine. And Kristen, I'm sure that you'll have a copy for each board member of the summations, just so we can, as we know, it's a living document, but still at this point in time. Next, we're going to go right to the local. Superintendent Davis, you're up.
Yes, ma'am, through the chair. And, you know, what we wanted to do is also figure out what we can do from a local perspective. You know, if we're going to have priorities for our organization openly, we cannot do this work in isolation. So what can we potentially partner with, you know, our municipalities, our community, our city, our Hillsborough County, to be able to kind of move forward in concert to help our students? So this is just a number of items that, you know, that we will continue to do with or without our municipalities, counties, or cities. But we want to be able to take a local platform to them so they can potentially help us advocate for potential funding or for ways of work. And in this, you know, a lot of it in the first wave is linked to literacy and closing the achievement gap. In order, if we're truly going to do this, we have got to focus on this at scale. We're educating families, parents, guardians, civic leaders, and joining educators, every one of the Tampa Bay areas, and our parents to be able to move in concert. So the first one's all about, when we have around 18,000 newborns that are each year within our local hospitals. So when we have a newborn, I openly think we need to have some type of care package from Hillsborough County Public Schools, introducing them to our organization, at the same time helping them, giving them parental educational resources, how to help through literacy, to be able to talk about, to give them books to read to their children, and or whether it's a teddy bear with Hillsborough County. I don't know what it is, us in the county to be able to work in concert. The second one is all about looking at having coordinated efforts for educational fairs throughout our, you know, community, and whether that's educational fairs about financial literacy, how to become a stronger reader, a stronger educator, as the parents, the first educator, how to be able to focus on a number of issues to help our children, through their educational career. And then the third one is all about being able to look at how we have partnerships with local libraries. You know, while every one of our students from K-8, while they're open to go to local libraries, how many students in our organization have actually been to one? And while we say, you know what, here you can have a library card, are we actually leveraging them, using them, and being able to take field trips? And the cost of this ask is to be able to find funding to make certain every student in K-8 has the availability to go in a coordinated effort through the county and through their district to go to check out books, to understand the power of the resources available. And then being able, the fourth one goes to be able to talk about how everything, you know, openly asking the county to coordinate all of their efforts with our school district related to infrastructure and technology. And this is something that you know, Mr. Bunkley is willing and ready to do, because everything that the county does impacts us, and what we can do and leverage other pockets in federal money or E-rate money can potentially help them connect all the dots in particular areas of need. And lastly, the last one is about under literacy and closing the achievement gap. It's about how we focus and continue to build upon beautiful partnerships with the ELC, early learning coalitions, to be able to help us identify and leverage 3 and 4 year old programs within our schools. We have 60% of our schools that are, our 60 schools that are 70% are under in capacity. How can we grow 3 and 4 year old programs to get into our schools, to start an earlier farm system, to get our children to understand emotional academic norms so they can be successful? And then in the school improvement, climate and culture perspective, goes back to making certain that we have the vaccine for, you know, coordinated with our essential workers and students who aspire to leverage it. And then the second one is kind of linked to some of the underlying concerns that we have related to transportation, infrastructure, siting, school sitings, those types of things, to be able to have a greater coordination. And the final one is partner with USF and their Mental Health Institute to reduce Baker Acts. And, you know, this is major for us. While, you know, the state really, you know, they did a really nice job standing up mobile response teams. And when you look at mobile response teams, what they've done, they just don't have the time to be able to be able to further get to any and all of our students. We have students that are waiting to be served by our mobile response teams. And then, you know, being able to ask for Hillsborough County Public Schools to have dedicated mobile response teams so that we can have more availability for our students, and that they can work to coordinate outside services where and if needed. So that's pretty much all of them.
Superintendent Davis, you're speaking from the heart, and we all know that local government is where we definitely can make a difference as board members. Just reflecting on what you're saying, and what we know is that we do, as a district, need to be competitive. We need to get into the act of competition, if you will. And now that we're narrowing it down to what we can do to be distinguished from other districts, so to speak, I think what you put into this verbiage is every one of them is critical. Just a few points. There is a class, and I'll speak on this later, the HOPE, which is a affective learning where students, seniors, that is, seniors and juniors, It's an elective, but unfortunately there's two electives. So there's a PE and then there's a HOPE. HOPE is more of the your mental health, the social norms, that which makes a teenager growing to a young adult healthy. Such aggravating consequences of suicide from COVID, anxiety, stress. You know, how does a young person handle the various stresses that go through? Well, this is what HOPE addresses, and it's from the state, and Kristen knows that. But we are going to Representative Toledo on Friday to have her hopefully write a bill to get this some traction. I'm adding this to an ad because I'll share it with you, so that would be part of our ask, but I think Kristen might want to do it on the state level. And again, with the vaccines, I know we have an appointment with Representative Kathy Castor to help hopefully facilitate getting this into our schools. The only other thing I have to say is when we talk about the interlocal agreement, seek amendments to the Hillsborough County Public Schools and local agreement and to have uniform standards, there has to be, and this is addressing all of us, we have to work with our Board of County Commissioners in unison to get what we want done, such as school sightings. And what this looks like, I know Stacy's on one of these committees, but I definitely want us as a board to focus on that, Superintendent Davis, with you, because we have some real needs in getting new schools. Okay, with that being said, next we have Member Snively.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So you got my spidey senses tingling when you mentioned something about writing a bill with Representative Toledo regarding the HOPE. Yeah. Health opportunity. Right. Is that, are you doing that as a school board member, or are you doing that not as a school board member?
No, I'm not doing it. Kristen.
Katie.
There's been initial conversations. We don't have a commitment or anything.
Okay. Well, the reason I ask is because we didn't talk about that as being a legislative priority. And so if we're going to be asking legislators to write bills for us, then if we ask them to write one bill, that means that we may not get them to write another bill. So we have to, if we're going to do that, we need to add that to our legislative priority list.
Point taken. Thank you. Can't go rogue.
Right. And so we, I don't know if the other board members want to chime in on that. I know we're back on state, and I do have some comments for the local, but that just
got my... maybe fleshing out and mm-hmm. maybe some internal conversations around it as well that for that particular issue that we need to work through.
Okay. All right. I just, that just got my flag up because we are, we didn't get a chance to really talk about it during the state priorities.
Righto.
And so, and when we ask for bills, we have to be pretty,
you're right.
There's gives and takes. Okay, so on the local platform, I just had two questions on the local platform, which is this is a little intriguing because I don't know that we've had a city county local platform. Is this the first time we've done this? This is new. This is brand spanking new. Okay, which is exciting, and I don't know why we've never done it before, but I'm glad that we are doing it because I think it's important to partner with our city and council municipalities. My first question is on the first half of the document on platform document under literacy and closing the achievement gap. All of them are going to cost money, and some have funding numbers attached to them. How does that work? How does the funding work? We're not expected to like put out any dollars for this, right? Are we asking for funding?
Through the chair, they receive additional dollars as well through CARES Act money as well. And then I know that Gretchen's been working to ask for close to around $10 million of additional funding. So this would be additional ask that they would have, money accessible to be able to help us do this.
Okay.
Right now, we love to do this. We just don't have the money to do it.
Right, and so I just didn't know if we had any monetary commitment to any of this, or we're just asking for these to be appropriated to us.
Yes, ma'am.
Is that right? Okay. And then on the second section under continuous school improvement and climate and culture, um, I I think these are great. I think they're challenging, but they're great. It's good. We should be talking about these things. I would love to see kind of an expansion of the what, because these are all the what, and I kind of like to see the how underneath these. Now, the first one is pretty, you know, self-explanatory. I mean, we want the school district staff and students to access the vaccine. What would that look like exactly if we got that, whether it's local, state, federal? Well, you know, how would that work?
So accessibility of the vaccine?
Right. You know,
so who
gets it first? And I don't, you don't have to answer me now. I'm just saying, you know, what I would like to see, a plan for what that looks like. And I'd like to see a plan for addressing the challenges in keeping pace with the growth, the what's the strategy behind that? And I'd like to see the strategy and the rationale and strategy and data behind bullet point number three, because I know that we're one of a school district that has some of the highest number of Baker Acts. And so I would like to see some of the data and rationale that support that, and what the plan, what the strategy would look like if we were able to have the get our way with these three bullet points.
Yes, ma'am.
But I think all of these are important, and I'd like to see them all stay priorities. So thank you.
Thank you, Member Snively. Member Combs?
As I'm looking at some of these, I'm just thinking of how are we trying to really market our schools and what we need to do as far as a city local platform to make sure that, you know, all of our voters and all of our parents know that what we offer in our schools. I think that's something as far as a local platform when we're looking at increasing funds in our district and having more funds. I mean, I think one of the things that we are not doing is marketing all the wonderful things that we have and all the programs that we have in our district. I think we need to be more effective with that. I think we did a great job when we tried to increase the half penny tax, but I think we need to really focus on the things that we are doing in our schools, and I think that's important because that will increase our funds, you know, as a totality. And also just looking at when we're looking at a city, county, local platform, I really think with the increase that we have of charter schools in the district, I would like to see that same transparency and that availability to people in Hillsborough County, all of our residents. So I think it's important as we look at the city and county local platform, we need to look at how we're going to market ourselves as a Hillsborough County Public Schools and how we're going to make sure that parents have the knowledge and the information to make the best choices as far as charter schools. And I don't feel that same transparency is there as we have. So I think that should be important in our city and local platform. Another thought I had is there are many malls. I'm thinking of District 1 and Citrus Park that are empty, and there's a lot of empty storefront. We're looking at places. Why not have maybe some type of marketing or information in those areas? And that could be a possible way of getting our name out there for people throughout. I mean, maybe not someplace like the International Mall, but most of these local malls have many empty storefronts. Maybe that would be an idea to partner with them and be able to, you know, have families find out about our schools and even ways to improve literacy and increase literacy through different storefronts like that. And finally, one last thing, which is not really city or local platform, and we're talking about all of the use of libraries. We really have to make sure as a district that our own libraries at our schools are not used constantly as test centers, and those are more open and accessible. So I think that's a very important part as we're looking at, you know, reading and literacy and how we want to reach out the community. But we also need to make sure within our schools those are always available and open for our students.
Thank you, Member Combs, and I'm taking notes from every one of you, so excuse my delay. Member Vaughn?
Thank you, Chair. So I love Nadia's thoughts of thinking outside the box and utilizing things to making sure that we're connecting with the community to talk about the things that we're doing so that we can be competitive when we're talking about our offerings. So I love that idea. I'm just going to go ahead and put some things as much as I agree with Board Member Snively that all of these are important. If we're talking about narrowing things down, I would just like to say that I definitely think when we're talking about looking at Baker Acting and reducing the number of Baker Actings and and mental health, and that combination is important, especially now when we're talking about the effects of COVID and what that's going to take, the toll that's going to take on our community. As well as, you know, I'm obviously advocating for the vaccine, so that's high on my priority list. I would also agree that some of this I would like to see some more fleshing out on, especially when we're talking about keeping pace with growth. There's some points here, but I would like to a better understanding of what that looks like holistically along with the county. So I'd love to get some more information on that. And then when we're talking about partnering with Hillsborough County government and other local organizations to better utilize fiber optics, I believe that's speaking directly to the digital divide that we've been having so much conversation about. So I think that's a really important one, because that's on the forefront, especially with COVID, talking about the inequities when it comes to access to the internet. So I think that's definitely something that we should prioritize. And I love, you know, working to making sure that we're expanding, you know, early childhood education and starting that pathway soon, because, you know, all these things are holistically connected. And when we talk about what we can do a better job for our students, making sure that we're hitting them earlier is very important. So the fifth one down under closing the achievement gap is something I'd like to prioritize. So thank you.
Thank you, Member Vaughn. Member Hahn?
Sorry. Thank you, Member Gray. So yeah, I'm glad that we're actually talking about a city-county platform. We haven't done that in the past. And I guess to kind of continue on some of the narrowing down comments that Member Vaughn had suggested. So number two obviously caught my eye, partnering with Hillsborough County government to provide coordinated and expanded education fairs in targeted communities to inform citizens, healthy habits, et cetera. And that is a space that, as you all know, I'm currently working in. I started that initiative when I last year. The first early childhood literacy fair was held at a public library. The reason that was location was chosen was because the public library is the hub, the literacy hub of our communities. And the second fair was just the weekend before Thanksgiving, and that was not at a public library. Obviously, because of COVID, we had to change the format. That was a drive-through fair. And those fairs, for those who don't know, involve partnering with community partners and are funded through community partners. So, and they will travel all over the district. So, and it's something I've also started talking to other members about, because it will travel into their districts because it is that important. So in addition to, yes, getting books and every child leaving with the home library, they also get dental sealants at those fairs. They also get fitted for free eyeglasses at those fairs. So we connect them with many different types of community partners and resources. So you know, as we're narrowing down, I would suggest, actually, since that's something I have committed to, that it does not need to be on this platform.
Okay. Sounds good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Member Hahn. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention the importance of those family community centers, Superintendent Davis, and the expansion. I put it under local. I don't know if it's here or not. And if it is here, I'm sorry I didn't pick it up, but the idea of increasing those family centers is critical for that outreach. Not only Wyomama, Ruskin, in Sefner, and Plant City, the language barrier in itself subtracts many, many students and families from getting into the technological arena, and the lack of communication in English to our Hispanic population is very great, and I know that you know that, and I know that Dr. Tarita is working on that earnestly. So at any rate, but following that, should we have nothing else to mention? Board members, do you have any final comments?
I have one question.
Okay, a question from Member Snively, and then after Member Snively, we'll have Member Combs.
Just the next steps. You know, where do we go from here? Committee weeks start soon in January, and I just want to kind of get an idea of what the next phase of this is for the school district.
Yes, ma'am, through the chair. So from my perspective, our team will go back before the board meeting, and we'll get all the prioritized elements in a one-pager for both the for every one of our legislative platforms for potential approval this evening. In addition, we'll go back and any asks that we've created. As of right now, we'll have a better understanding for strategies for how that vaccine will be, what it will look like, who will be able to administer it, when will that be available. Also looking at other school improvement and culture and climate related to the county. You know, what's the infrastructure issues? What's the collaboration with the county? What does it look like for potential task force for siting? And then transition into Baker acting. What's the how? What's the need? What's the overall platform? And then giving an additional update of where our community school projects currently lie with all of the resources that we offer, and determine overall the return on investment. And if we are growing, not only from the academic perspective, but what are we doing to leverage community partnerships? What are we doing to leverage mental health services, clinical services where needed? And then we'll be prepared for this evening. And this evening, if there's need to be any conversation, we'll put on a discussion to be able to make adjustments.
So will you bring back what we talked about today to the January board meeting? We don't have to vote. Do we have to vote on the platform at the board meeting in January?
So the ideally, you'd vote on it this afternoon.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
already.
I think, and again, as you pointed out, Ms. Snively, and for board members, it's a living document, and it will change. But I think it's important that you all do that this afternoon. And so, if you're comfortable with it when you see it, it'll stay on consent. Otherwise, it'll be a discussion on it. But you do need to vote on it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. So through the chair, we'll make certain that we clean it up as presented today. And if there needs to be a pause in January, we'll create that pause. We'll try to get it done today for each of you to interact with.
Thank you, Superintendent Davis.
Katie.
I'm so sorry. Go ahead, Ms. Davis.
Flesh out a little bit more. I know Ms. Snively asked about next steps, so that's immediate today. We will have ready for you. And after that, to Dr. Hahn's point, we will then start creating some information packets that will be your go-to information. They will be one-pagers. And so we're envisioning like a one-pager infographic for each local, state, and federal, and then supplemental information for each ask. So you are prepared when you walk in, as well as additional platforms, whether it's FAFSA, CTA, CASA, FADS, you know, FSBA, all those. And so that was it. I'm sure there's more, but.
And actually, I'm just going to jump in. There are more steps, last steps, because I'd like to get more information on the corporate partnerships. Dr. Hahn, definitely would like for the board members that are new to understand what our lobbyists do and what they encompass. And also the workshop on community schools, I think, was something we want to put on the future workshop agenda. I think, Superintendent Davis, there will be need for more consensus from the board on the local. That's a positive way. I mean, positive input. And also, I agree with the future of higher level marketing, as Member Combs mentioned as well. As we go along, now I would like to hear from Member Combs.
Yeah, I had a quick question for the superintendent. I'm so glad to see that you're prioritizing testing in Spanish or whatever language for the children in the state. I mean, could we also add that to the federal level? I mean, I know it's a state test, but I mean, should the federal government really prioritize and start considering, testing and all together supporting states for that?
Yes, ma'am. Through the chair, they already allow that through the NAEP. So the National Assessment, Educational Assessment, that we're a part of it, they allow that to take place. So they've done a really nice job from a national federal perspective. The local perspective is the one we currently have to push, and I'll allow KD, then Monica, kind of to expand.
Yeah, and KD, I guess we just would love to see the data on other states. I know that I think California has it in like 34 languages. I mean, I know state by state. I would love to see states that are similar to us and what they're doing and how that's happening, because I think that's really important for our school grades and how that affects Hillsborough County and it affects our state.
I'll let Monica. I think maybe Monica want to jump in on this. That'd be great.
Sure. Thank you, through the chair. So under ESSA, in addition to the NAEP, ESSA allows for states to adopt, as you mentioned, our state assessment in a variety of native languages for students. So Florida has not chosen to do so. And quite frankly, probably because of the expense. It's very, very expensive to do so. So if you look at our legislative priority, we've also included an option that would allow for the student ELL committee to meet and determine whether or not the student's results of the FSA is not adequate due to their language barrier, and will be able to then waive the results for the purpose of graduation if the team can demonstrate that the student has mastery of the standards through other mechanisms. That's the exact same language we have right now in statute for students with disabilities. The IEP team can meet, the teachers and the staff who know the student best meet and determine whether or not the student's tests should be waived for the purposes, they still take the assessment, but waived for the purposes of graduation. So this would not stop them from graduating. Thank you.
Does that still impact the school grade? I mean, it may not impact the individual, but does that still in consideration of that?
Sorry. So through the chair, openly it would, because you'd have more students to become and meet proficiency, and also additional, you know, with the gatekeepers of EOCs, with Algebra 1, also with the 10th grade FSA, they would have a stronger ability to meet the thresholds identified by the state. So openly impact school grade and district grade.
So I just wanted to say thank you for hosting this again. Thank you for the first time having a local platform and that we're talking about it holistically. I know board member Han graciously yielded her literacy workshop so we could talk about this today. And I just want to say that I think it's a really good start to having these broader conversations that we collectively should be having. So I appreciate this workshop.
Thank you, Member Vaughn. Appreciate your comments. Ms. Gray had to step away from the dais, so I have a few questions, quick questions. One, who is going to be preparing those one-pagers for us once this is finalized?
So we'll work with individual staff that have the content along with our communications team.
And then our lobbyists obviously will be involved in that
absolutely.
Process. So if we could just, I'd like to request see that before it's finalized to provide some input, that would be appreciated. And then for this afternoon, we'll be provided with the one-page cover sheets, and then we're going to finalize that. Okay. Any final comments before we close today's workshop? I know Ms. Gray was on a tight schedule for 11:30, but I'm happy to take any final comments. No? Okay, then meeting adjourned.
Thank you.